Been sitting on this replay for quite some time, but considering this exploit is most likely going to be patched out within the next week or two with the 1.1 update, at least hopefully, I don't mind sharing it now at this point. What are you looking at here? Well, it's an Infinite Winds of Magic exploit utilizing Cathay overcharge specifically with the compasses. Now, compasses are a little bit of a meme unit, which is why this exploit is arguably not actually very good. But what they allow you to do with the Shugengan Lord with an item that we'll look at in just a second once we load in is to get additional Winds of Magic power reserve and enough recharge rate that you can consistently generate infinite Winds of Magic by casting this lowest tier Dragon's Breath damage spell here. I suppose you could also do it with Jade Shield as it is even cheaper, but we're specifically going to be using the Dragon's Breath. No spells on the Alchemist, as you'll see once we get into battle. They're here just to add their Mastery of the Elemental Winds, so we've got 5 units adding to that. Also in the starting army, a Grand Cannon, Jade Warrior Crossbow Shield, 2 Jade Warriors, and a Peasant Long Spear, 2 Longmas in reserve, 4 more Jade Crossbow Shields, 2 Halberds, 3 Jade Warriors, 3 Peasant Archers, and 2 Peasant Long Spears. My opponent, my patron Spudhouse here, going to be coming in with a Herald of Tzeentch, Lore of Metal, Lord of Change also, a couple of Exalted Pink Horrors, and some Blue Horrors as well. I believe this guy also has a similar item. We'll have to look at it in just a second where he can get quite a bit of extra Winds of Magic, but we'll see. 3 Chaos Knights in reserve, very strong, with 4 Forsaken, also very strong, 1 Flamer, and 4 Furies. I like that build quite a bit. Although I do think the Herald can be somewhat risky in this matchup, as Cathay can actually challenge you reasonably well in the air. He's also not at too much of a risk, just because it's very likely you can win that air fight if you take the appropriate build. Here, Spudhouse doesn't have any Doom Knights to help in the air fight, but at the same time, the Lord of Change plus the Herald is enough of a presence that certainly my Shugengan by herself won't be able to take it on, but what is the item I'm talking about here? It's this one, the Jade Amulet. So you'll notice gives only 0.1 reserves per second, but as many people have pointed out, that does mean that with the extra recharge rate, the extra 160%, plus additional 20% each from both of these, you get just a ton of extra recharge rate, enough that you can generate at least 6 Winds of Magic, enough to get this Dragon's Breath again, right? Which is the whole idea, the way to generate infinite Winds of Magic. I think if I remember my testing right, I apologize, I didn't actually save my testing specific against the AI, but you also wouldn't be able to see the Winds of Magic anyway in a replay, which is another discussion entirely. But anyway, I think it returns something like 7 Winds of Magic, if I remember correctly. So you actually do get an additional +1. So I guess you could farm it to get other spells. But anyway, just advancing up to the center with my initial starting force here. We've got the compasses and Alchemist tight in formation here to get some nice harmony modifiers, along with these Jade Warrior crossbowmen, just providing the yin to everyone here. Meanwhile, the cannon sitting out on the far side, Peasant Long Spear is also providing harmony over there. Just kind of skirmishing, doing a little bit of a cannon poke here. Managed to beat the barriers down on both of these flying Tzeentch units, which is always nice. Do a bit of true HP damage. Flying single entities for Tzeentch can be an absolute terror to deal with, so pretty good there. Some nice pink fire as well, going to be unleashed on those Jade Warrior crossbowmen. Let's look at the specific loadout here of the Herald of Tzeentch. Yeah, he's got this here, which I guess you can't necessarily generate infinite Winds of Magic because it has a relatively long cooldown, and it is on use rather than being activated when casting. But here we're going to hit a double punch of the Dragon's Breath and a Comet, just absolutely destroy 2 Blue Horrors. I mean, arguably a little bit overkill for just 2 Blue Horrors, but still, I'm going to clear through that very cost-effective chaff as quickly as we can. You can see I've already taken quite a bit of magical fire damage straight to the face on my little functional force here, so we're gonna advance, try and get those Jade Warriors into combat if we can, but this sort of magical shock cavalry attack here has done a pretty good job of breaking Tzeentch's flank open. That being said, I am taking significant damage on my Longmas, also dealing significant damage to the Tzeentchian single entities here. And more importantly, none of my single entities are really taking too much damage. I mean, looks like a couple of hits on the Shugengan Lord there. The compasses really not being focused too much. My opponent Spudhouse just focusing down the infantry, which he is able to do pretty efficiently, but arguably, you know, with the decent enough armor-piercing damage, these Exalted Pink Horrors should probably be firing at the compasses, but that's a topic for another day, perhaps. The knights are moving in now. And they don't really have too many avenues to try and get back up and around. I'm also going to try and drop a comet on them directly. So far, so good. We keep sort of a high-level view here. You can see some bombardments also from that Lore of Metal, that Searing Doom. Pretty cost-effective in general. Really nice bombardment. That comet, though, just did a ton of damage to those Chaos Knights. Just smashing the whole unit. It does seem like Comet has been significantly improved in terms of damage output. And keep in mind as well that all of these spells are being overcharged. I mean, it doesn't show on the tooltip right here, but these guys do have Master of the Elemental Winds, so I would assume they are getting the extra intensity here. Certainly the Dragon's Breath is, even still with the Tzeentchian Shields, that eats some of the damage, but we're able to get some true HP damage in as well. Support is thinning very quickly. Finally, those Tzeentch Knights manage to get back and start to shut down the cannon. Cannon's used up about half of its ammunition so far, but as tattered as those Tzeentch Knights are, the Peasant Long Spears should be able to get in and protect. In terms of actual objectives, so the objectives have opened up. I'm sending a little functional force over there to capture objective number one. Spudhouse committing very heavily to the center has not sent anything so far. It looks like now pulling in some blue horse to go cap objective number three, but he is starting a slight lead in the fact that he's been able to hold this center objective at least for the time being. But the counter push from Cathay is starting to work. I mean, certainly the compasses, although they've taken some damage now, this one at least has, they're surviving. Not necessarily thriving, but able to somewhat win this engagement here. Even if the infantry paid the ultimate price, you can see the alchemists also kind of tailing. Just getting all up underneath, like checking the oil on the compass there. Doing a full-on inspection of the undercarriage, which is just amazing. Spudhouse is going to actually pull his forces back and just kind of reposition, re-secure, get everything back together, secure that objective number three. Meanwhile, I'm going to do a similar thing on objective number two here, just kind of bring my forces up, get reformed, if you will. Over here, same thing, this little functional group. Just, I like doing this as Cathay just so that you can try and maintain harmony, and it's a little bit more of a threat, kind of regardless of what he sends out here. I at least can threaten it to a small degree. Certainly a force of Tzeentch Knights would be very scary, but also would significantly outcost. Probably be effective at the end of the day, but another Searing Doom going to be dropped here. Thankfully, I do spot it in time to mostly dodge it. Taking a little bit of chunk damage right there, not too much. But let's see. Tzeentch is definitely still prowling. There's still tons of time left in terms of points. Victory tickets, if you will. We're going to fast forward a little bit through this mid-game as we both kind of reposition here. Objective number three is secured, and I come back in, start to drop some hot dragon fire. That one didn't do too much, did punch through the barrier of those very weak and exalted pink horrors, but cannon's still online. Fury's coming in to try and shut it down. It looks like it's down to actually one individual cannon model, the other ones having been destroyed by that cavalry attack a little earlier. So painful stuff for me, but the one cannon can still poke and at least provide some barrier damage, prevent these units from replenishing their barrier too much, and keep things a little more fair. Just kind of holding on the center objective for now, not really needing to do too much. The Herald still has plenty of ammunition though. He's gonna start to pick away at my single entities as he has been doing for a good chunk of the battle so far. Mobile units kind of sweeping through the gap right here. Gonna get a nice flank attack. Going directly after the compass. Spudhouse realizing at this point that he needs to take out those magic tools in order to, not allow me to just continue to sling spells for the rest of the game. Furies finally do get through and shut down that Grand Cannon, but we're going to get a nice counterattack with some summoned Longmas. It should be a pretty good engagement for me. I mean, the cannon was pretty much done already, had probably paid for itself. In fact, let's take a look here at the information scroll. And yeah, definitely paid for itself already, so that's all well and dandy. Meanwhile, more pink fire as the Dragon-Blooded Lord here drops in. A couple of Tzeentch Forsaken have been summoned in. This is going to be a pretty scary force to deal with at this point. The Tzeentch Forsaken just very strong in melee against most Cathayan units. And with plenty of missile support still online, this engagement's very quickly going to turn against me. Not to mention more Tzeentch Knights coming in there. So yeah, Jade Warrior is very weakened at this point, starting to lose out on some of my casters as well. So if we look, we've got Compass routing off. We've got an Alchemist routing off. The intensity is going to be down to only 130%. Each mastery of the winds addition adds an additional 15%, right? And you see now that compass comes back from route, and it should be, 145% again, right? So, another benefit of the compasses, though, is they can cast a pretty long range. So this one's going to be a swing and a miss, but it did at least force those pink horrors to move and not just stay stationary and continue shooting. Didn't really help my forces in the area, though, as they all still get routed off anyway. That Tzeentch Doom Knight, or not Doom Knight, regular Knight, coming in to break things up. Longma's doing their best as well. Man, that gold against the blue is a really nice contrast, even if not necessarily the biggest fan of the Blueberry Forsaken. I mean, in terms of it mechanically and just thematically, I do love them. I just think the execution on the shiny blue armor, it just, it's not my favorite. Anyway, hope for the future. At least for the present, Longmas are starting to take some damage in melee against those Forsaken. Still, though, Shingon Lord going to try and come in and get a few more Dragon's Breaths. At this point, we won't be able to continue to farm magic. The magic tools are starting to get broken up, and the intensity is significantly down. But points-wise, I've been able to hold this center objective, even though I am slowly starting to lose. Got a couple Halberds in here as well. Mixed in on those Tzeentch Knights, that should be a pretty good engagement for me. Compass coming back through, and oh man, that was a juicy one. That Flame Breath attack right there. I think I momentarily had most of my casters back from route, or at least two of them, for a little bit of extra intensity there, but no shields to protect those blue horrors. Man, again, maybe not the best value even still, but my Shooting God Lord does pay the price. Getting routed off by Lord of Change still has generated almost 3,000 damage value. Just absolutely beast mode on one single spell, pretty much, and a little bit of melee fighting. Very impressive stuff, and the compasses as well, as we'll see in just a minute, have actually done a pretty good amount of damage on their Comet Lightning drops. Oh no, the enemy has slain the Lord. Yes, the Shugengan Lord goes down. Very cheeky little drops, but House actually hard-landed the Lord of Change here and sniped her with a blue fire there. You can see the magic missile. Now Lord of Change pops back up into the air, is going to sweep away, try and get back to some supporting units. The issue, though, is that these Doom Knights are the ones kind of holding this objective at this point, and I managed to get some more Halberds on station. These other Halberds also barely survived that attack. The Forsaken just barely running out of steam. More Forsaken sweeping in, though. Will Spudhouse be able to capture this center objective? He's not too far behind right now. If he did cap the center, he could hold it and then win on two objectives, but it's getting close to the point where he will need a three cap. Let's see what he can do here. Certainly my magic farming build has been fully disrupted at this point, and I'm just gonna have to win through old school steel and gunpowder and, you know, maybe dragon faith or whatever. Yeah, the Eastern Empire, gotta love it. Cannon shots landing in here. Forsaken getting a good charge. The Jade Halberds, oof, taking maybe a little bit of friendly fire right there, but holding a line admirably. They're definitely taking some significant damage, but still Crossbowmen on station as well. They're not within Harmony range. This is one thing, like, one thing they could do to buff Cathay is, like, these guys should probably be providing Harmony, even though, I don't know, Harmony should be, like, 100 meters. Maybe not that far, but, like, 90, 80 or 90. Maybe that's too much. They said they, yeah, we're going to look into that, but we'll see. With 1.1, with the balance changes, I do hope that radius for Harmony gets increased. Maybe not by that much, but anyway. Kind of getting off topic here. Cannons raining in death from afar. I've still got these two Jade Warriors, or yeah, the Jade Warriors, Peasant Archers, just holding out there. Furies are going to come tie them down, but it's not too much worry in terms of capture weight, and at this point, but I was going to throw in the towel. I was close enough to winning that he would have needed to three cap me, and there's not really a realistic chance of him doing that. So there it is. Hopefully you guys enjoyed watching that one. It's definitely interesting. I don't know. Again, it's technically an exploit. I don't know if it's actually that good because you have to take two compasses and the Shugengan Lord. But Shugengan Lord managed to bring back, 3,626 value. Just absolutely ridiculous. Very, very good. And one of the compasses also, 1478 damage value itself, so got some work with those non-bound actual spells. The other one did nothing, but that's okay. The recharge rate and the Mastery of the Winds definitely helped the other units, certainly. Cannon also, summon twice, almost pays for itself twice, very effective. Crossbows here, the shielded crossbows can trade pretty well into Tzeentch. The Alchemists, again, same thing. They only cost 300, so you just kind of add their value onto the Chugengun Lord, and it's still cost-effective. Longmas paying for themselves is nice to see as well. I'm a fan of the Flying Cavalry as a unit type, so nice to see when they perform. Gives me hope that Bretonnia won't be completely useless when they are added with Immortal Empires. On the Tzeentch side, considering how cheap the Herald of Change is, he probably gets reasonably close to actually paying for himself. Not sure, I'd have to look. Lord of Change, same thing. Not quite, but pretty close. Exalted Pink Horror is also not a unit I've used a ton, personally. Generally seems to be better to just go wide with lots of blue and regular Pink Horrors, but still, one of them does manage to pay for themselves. Blue Horror is generally pretty cost-effective. You don't need to do a lot with them to pay for themselves, and they, for the most part, do. Tzeentch Knight, same thing. Pretty decent, all things considered. Also for the Forsaken, two of them pay for themselves, two of them do not. And the Furies failed to shut down the cannon in a timely manner, although they were able to eventually shut it down. Did manage to get quite a bit of value back beforehand, so kind of credit that to the Longmas and some other factors. But anyway, hopefully you guys enjoyed this. A little bit of Cathayan cheese for what it's worth. Cathay is a faction that's not generally very strong in domination, so maybe I don't feel that bad cheesing with them. I don't know. Let me know what you guys think in the comments below. Hopefully you enjoyed. Like this sort of content, be sure to like, subscribe, hit that bell notification. Every time I upload a new video, you'll be notified. Thanks again. We'll see you next time.